Welcome to Petrified Forest National Park. This place is more than just a collection of fossilized trees. These trees represent over 200 million years of Earth history, as do the beautiful layers that they sit in. In today's video, we'll walk through the geologic history of this region from the surprisingly lush landscapes of the Triassic period when all this was deposited to the arid desert that's here today. Starting in the Triassic period around 225 million years ago, this region was part of a vast subtropical floodplain located near the equator of the supercontinent Pangea. Picture towering conifer forests, ferns, and cycads lining slow-moving rivers and oxbow lakes. And actually, this was before flowering plants had evolved, so no flowers were around just yet. The major global theme at the time was recovery. Life was just coming out of the worst mass extinction in the last 550 million years, the End Permian extinction, which is also nicknamed the Great Dying because it took out over 90% of all life on Earth. With so many newly opened ecological niches, the Triassic was a time of evolutionary experimentation. Both dinosaurs and mammals were just starting to evolve and diversify. And these early dinos and mammals roamed alongside large amphibians and crocodile-like phytosaurs. And while there weren't oceans here at the time, just to give global context, ocean life at the time looked very different as well. While marine mammals that we know and love today, like dolphins and whales, hadn't evolved yet by this time, there were some creatures in the oceans that looked similar, but were much more terrifying in the Triassic. These were marine reptiles, like ichthyosaurs and plesiosaurs and mosasaurs that were just coming on the scene in the Mesozoic. And they continued to thrive and diversify for the whole Mesozoic era, around 100 million years. But this region wasn't just diverse with respect to life. It was also geologically dynamic, shaped by frequent floods, volcanic activity, and shifting tectonic plates. For example, if we fast forward a few million years, we see the deposition of the Chinle Formation, these beautiful colored layered rocks that make up the Petrified Forest. These sediments were deposited by rivers and floods. In this formation, we find mudstones, siltstones, and sandstones, each one representing a different environment. Finer-grained mudstones representing floodplain deposition and coarser-grained sandstones representing more rapid river deposition. And the vibrant colors here come from iron and manganese alteration as groundwater flowed through these rocks. Each hue tells a story of its own. Red layers indicating more oxidizing conditions, so very oxygen-rich waters, and more greenish-grayish layers indicating more reducing conditions or oxygen-poor waters. But finally, to the reason we're all here. How did these forests turn into stone? So recall that we're still in the late Triassic period, over 200 million years ago, during which this area was covered in forests and trees, many of which lined rivers. And trees that fell into these rivers were rapidly buried by sand, mud, and volcanic ash from nearby volcanic eruptions. And this rapid burial cut off oxygen, preventing decay of the wood. And over the next several million years, groundwater rich in silica from nearby volcanic eruptions seeped into the buried wood. And this silica replaced the organic material of the wood cell by cell, until it turned it completely into just pure silica, which silica is just silicon dioxide, SiO2, which is essentially what glass is. It's what quartz is. And so these are kind of glass logs, which is cool. And you may be wondering, why doesn't this happen to rocks? Why isn't everything just replaced by silica and turned into essentially quartz or glass? Well, wood has amazing pores. And these pores allow water to get in there and fill cracks and crevices and pore spaces. And the walls of these pores or cracks in the wood are great, what we call nucleation sites for precipitation of the silica or kind of crystallization of the silica in that space. And because silica is so much stronger than the organic material that makes up the wood originally, it eventually replaces all of that organic material, but it retains the original structure and shape of the wood, which is so cool. And it's not just the overall shape and structure of the trunks that are preserved. It's also the microscopic structures of like tree rings and stuff. A lot of cases in this petrified wood, you can still see the tree rings in the structures, which is incredible. And the pore spaces where the water initially was filling before the silica precipitated. And all these colors we see here, the reds, the yellows, the purples, are due to impurities, iron and manganese mostly, impurities in the silica. Silica in its purest form is colorless. It's the amazing impurities, these trace metal impurities, that give these petrified trunks their amazing color. By the time we reached the Jurassic period, around 200 million years ago, this once lush floodplain started to dry out. Globally, Pangea was beginning to break up, creating rift basins and altering climates. In this region, erosion began to expose some of the petrified logs, but most remained buried. The rivers that once defined this landscape became less active, and the region transformed into a more arid environment. Fast forwarding to the late Cretaceous, around 70 million years ago, Pangea was long gone, and the Rocky Mountains were just beginning to form due to the Laramide orogeny, a massive mountain building event caused by tectonic collisions along western North America. This also caused the uplift of the Colorado Plateau, including the region that we're in, the Petrified Forest. This uplift raised the region thousands of feet, exposing all these rocks to erosion and creating the incredible landscapes we see today. Fast forwarding again to the Miocene epoch around 6 million years ago, this region had become the arid desert that we know it as today. As rivers dried up and rainfall diminished, the exposed petrified logs remained remarkably well preserved due to the region's dry climate. And because petrified wood is so resistant in itself, because it's silica and silica is inherently resistant and resilient toward weathering and dissolution, erosion in this region over tens of millions of years has revealed these incredible fossilized treasures. Because the chimney formation of rocks that hold them are much more weatherable and erodible. But even with all that we know about the petrified forest today and how it came to be, some mysteries still remain. For example, scientists are still debating the exact kind of conditions that led to such prolific silicification and petrification of all the wood here. Was it just from silica-rich ash from nearby volcanoes? Or was there a unique groundwater chemistry involved? And let's not forget the bigger picture. How exactly did the Colorado Plateau rise to such elevations without significant folding or faulting? These are ongoing research questions that I highly encourage you to look into if you're interested. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed this video about the beautiful petrified forest. And as always, my references are linked down below, and I will see you guys in the next one. Bye. Comment down below where you want me to go next.
So I just wanted to share some more beautiful B-roll from this place because it was so incredible, both the rock layers and the petrified wood. But I also wanted to share the moment where I found...
Look at that trunk. I thought that that was a layer of rocks, but it's just a full-ass tree. Oh my god. This is incredible. There's a whole valley of it. And then not to mention the beautiful rocks. I mean, what? I'm in a wonderland of petrified wood that... I'm not allowed to take. It's so hard. Look at that.
I mean, it's just literally everywhere. It's so cool.
Okay, so you know I had to come up here and actually see this log for myself. Look at it. It preserved not only the structures, but look at how the trunk structures were preserved there. And this branch over here that used to branch off the main trunk. I mean, oh my gosh, this is incredible.
Anyway, I highly recommend you come here for yourself. This was actually my favorite part. Well, probably my favorite part from this trip, which, you know, you can see all the places we went on my Instagram. So go check that out. But we went a lot of cool places. And this one is up there for the top place. It's so cool, you guys. Especially the geologic story behind it.